Guys, good morning. Here we are, ready to go. Bright and early, right? You guys awake? Awesome. Good to have you guys here. It's good to see some of you back that have been gone. And today we continue a new series. Hey, listen, let me just remind you what Forge is. Forge is a place where God builds great men as God defines greatness. The world has too many passive men. It has too many bad men. It has a lot of good men, but what the world needs is great men. And God is the only one I know that builds great men. And so I'm glad you're here. That's what we're about. And today we're going to be starting a new series. There it is, Truth, the Foundation of Manly Confidence. Let me say that again. Truth, the foundation of what kind of confidence? Manly confidence. I'm glad you were able to say that with me because we are about men. We're about all things men. Does God care for women? Of course he does. But he's here to develop his boys as well and to develop his boys into men and to have that confidence. This past weekend, I was up in Tallahassee doing a men's seminar with a good group of guys up there. And I looked at the news and noticed that Danny Garcia was going to fight Saturday night. I don't know. Anybody watch the pay-per-view fight with Danny Garcia? No, you don't even know who he is. He's the welterweight was the welterweight champion of the world. And the reason I know that is because I quoted him in my book, Like Father, Like Son. Hey, let me tell you a footnote, which is interesting. Talking about confidence and boldness, I have a really bold friend who lives in St. Louis, and he was invited to a 12-member gathering with Vice President Pence 2 weeks ago. I posted this on my website. And so what does he take in? Does he take the Bible? No, he takes my book. He hands it to Vice President Pence. It was the coolest thing ever. And they got a picture of him. I posted it on the website. I am famous. Vice President Pence looked at the book, flipped through it, and said, "Who is this? What is it?" No. He actually has a look of interest on his face. And I love the boldness. I love the confidence. But in that book, wow, that was a long way around the block. In that book, I talk about Danny Garcia and his father, Angel, who is his trainer. So I got home and I watched, well, Tuesday, I finally was able to get to the clip. And Danny lost the fight by split decision. So he's no longer the world champion. But Angel Garcia has a mouth like, and I was going to say Army Sergeant, but he's got a mouth like somebody from Brooklyn or whatever, man. This guy was foul on national TV because his son lost. But I love the reality of his strength, his confidence, even though he got his first loss. Actually, he told his son, "I think he should retire right now." He was ticked. But listen, as we think about the whole, what do boxers do just before the fight? What are they doing in the promotions? Do you know what they're face to face, aren't they? They're standing like there and they're looking face to face. Why are they that way? Because if you're going to go into a combat with somebody whose hands are lethal weapons, you better have confidence. You better be able to promote and project bravado, intimidation, confidence. And he did, and he still lost. But the reality is, guys, when it comes to the real world in which we live in a big, bad, dangerous world. And if a man is going to make it in a world like this, he's got to have some level of confidence, of bravado. We want it. We need it. Do we always have it? This is a Christian gathering of men. Do we always have that kind of confidence? No. Do we do things to ourselves that limit that confidence from time to time? Do we ever feel insecure and act very secure? Of course. I would say in the course of a day, we are like that often. So confidence is a big part of living as a man in this world. And the question is, what causes manly confidence? The answer is truth. And that's why we're going to be starting a new series. And I'm not going to be teaching this whole series, but I'm going to be teaching two of the four. And you're going to really benefit as we look into the Bible to gain the confidence that we need as men. It is the Bible. It is the truth that gives us the confidence that we need as men. Speaking of confidence and fear, how many of you have seen Hacksaw Ridge? Yeah. I saw it again the other day with my daughter. She hadn't seen it. So we pay-per-viewed it, watched it. And it's an absolute... I love that story. There's so many aspects of application about that. Desmond Doss is the conscientious objector in World War II who goes up in the Battle of Okinawa. And he's a conscientious objector, no gun, nothing. And he saved 70, this doesn't ruin the movie. He saved 75 wounded American soldiers. And the guys who belittled him in boot camp and in training, when they were on the ridge shot, the toughest guy, when he's shot and Desmond Doss shows up, he says, "I'm afraid." Doss says, "So am I." And he saved his life. So we deal with fear a great deal. But it is biblical confidence that comes from truth that we absolutely need. I'm going to read a text of Scripture, then I'm going to explain it, exposit it, and then we'll get into it. I'm not going to read all of 2 Peter 1, 1 through 16. I'm not going to put it all up here. I'm going to read it, though, as a basis. Then I got 4 points for you. You ready? Here we go. 2 Peter 1, 1. Simeon, Peter, this is the English Standard Version. Not all your Bibles will actually translate it Simeon, Peter, but as I'll explain in a minute, that's actually his name, Simeon, or how else is it put, guys? Simon, that's how you know it. That's the diminutive form of Simeon. Simeon, Peter, a servant, an apostle of Christ, to those who have obtained a faith of equal standing with ours by the righteousness of our God and Savior, Jesus Christ. Now, go down, if you have your Bibles, to verse 16. Because after explaining who we are in Christ and what the gospel has done for us, and I'm jumping ahead because we're focusing on the truth of Scripture, he says in verse 16, "For we did not follow cleverly devised myths when we made known to you the power and coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, but we were eyewitnesses of his majesty. For when he received honor and glory from God the Father, and the voice was borne to him by the majestic glory, quote, 'This is my beloved Son with whom I'm well pleased,' we ourselves heard this very voice born from heaven, for we were with him on the holy mountain. And we have something more sure, the prophetic word, to which you will do well to pay attention, as to a lamp shining in a dark place until the day dawns and the morning star rises in your hearts. Knowing this," underline these words, "first of all, that no prophecy of Scripture comes from someone's own interpretation. For no prophecy was ever produced by the will of man, but men spoke from God as they were carried along by the Holy Spirit. But false prophets also arose among the people, just as there will be false teachers among you who will secretly bring in destructive heresies, even denying the master who bought them, bringing upon themselves swift destruction. And many will follow them, their sensuality, and because of them, the way of the truth will be," what's that word, guys? "Blasphemed. And in their greed, they will exploit you with false words. Their condemnation from long ago is not idle, and their destruction is not asleep." This is God's holy word. Now, guys, I want you to see four realities here about the Bible, about truth, that helps us get that confidence in our life, a true, manly, biblical confidence. You want to have confidence, don't you? I do, too. And so, first of all, I want you to note, and this is really important, I want you to note the ultimate author of the Bible, which we see in verse 1 and then again in verses to follow. You're not going to be able to read this, but you can read the addresses, right? That's all. You can look these up later, or if you have your Bible, and you should bring your Bible if you're spiritual. How about that for guilt? Bring your Bible. It's on your phone. Don't do your emails here, but bring your Bible and follow along in this series. Notice how Peter self-identifies. He calls himself Simeon Peter. Simeon was his Hebrew covenant name given by his parents at his physical birth, right? Peter was his nickname given to him by Jesus at his spiritual rebirth. When Jesus met him, what did he name him? He named him He named him Peter. He said, "You're Simon. I'm calling you Rocky." The rock. Was Peter always a rock? No, because we know of one time he's not. But it's interesting. He's called Simon in John when he's restored by Jesus. He's not always a rock. He denied Jesus. But was Peter often a rock, guys? He really was. He was one of the major leaders. He's the leader of the church in Jerusalem. He really was a rock most of the time. He entered a room mouth first most of the time. He talked. Sometimes he had to repent, but he was a leader. He was a rock. And that's how he identifies. He puts his Hebrew name and his nickname given to him by Jesus together. Simon Peter the Rock. Years later, though, here he is writing this letter. And how does he identify? He identifies himself as a servant and as a, what's the other one? An apostle. First of all, as a servant, doulos, often translated bondservant. In the Old Testament, there was a situation where a guy could be a slave to a great master. And when he got his freedom, when he earned his, he paid his debt and got his freedom, he could come and say, "I don't want to be free. I want to be your servant. Man, I got a house here. I got food. You're actually a good master." So what would he do? He'd put his earlobe on a doorpost, and the pastor would take an awl and do what? Pierce it. Do you guys wear earrings? I'm guessing it's because you want to be seen as a bondservant of Jesus Christ. If you don't, that's okay. You don't have to. That's a different culture. But anybody that wears earrings, I'd say, well, then maybe they're a bondservant of Jesus Christ. That's the deal. But that's what they would do. And Peter self-identifies here as a bondservant, as a doulos, as somebody who's willing to be on mission every day for his master. And I love that idea of waking up on mission as a bondservant. That's an energizing way to wake up. Not good Lord, it's morning, but good morning, Lord. You know, I like that. To wake up on mission, I don't get there until I have some coffee. But that's the reality, is that when Peter woke up, he was on mission as an apostle. Now, I want you to note what he says. Another point that's very important for us here as men is he says, as he calls us, all as men who have equal standing before God. Did you see that? Let me read it again, just briefly. He says, to those who have obtained a faith of equal standing as ours. As Peter writes, he writes to these guys, and he says to the churches in Asia Minor that he's writing to, he says, we all have equal standing. In this room, gentlemen, look around you. There are not two levels of Christians. There's one. There are pastors in this room, and we love our pastors, don't we? There are spiritual leaders in our nation that we appreciate a great deal. There's only one level of Christian. The ground is very level at the foot of the cross. I have a Rev before my name. That makes me more spiritual, right? How many believe that? I love that. I love that. See, we are both reverend doctors. That's pretty impressive, isn't it? Yeah. But not before God. Because before God, our core identity as men who put faith in Christ is what? We're all sons. And Peter wants to make it very clear that even though his second title, which he's going to talk about in a minute, is that he's an apostle, we are equal. Gentlemen, you need to claim, and I want you to claim your identity in Christ as a son, and understand that there is, when if you put others above you spiritually, you're demeaning yourself spiritually. Because we have a faith of equal standing in Christ. Christ is the one that elevates us. Now notice, this is fascinating. He says, if you look at this this verse again, verse 1 and 2, our equal standing before God is by the righteousness of our God and Savior, Jesus Christ. That's crucial. I'm going to unpack that. You ready to do some grammar? Okay, it's early. We're going to do some grammar. It's by our equal standing before God is by the righteousness of our God and Savior, Jesus Christ. There's a rule in grammar that in Greek grammar, not English grammar, but in Greek grammar, that when two nouns have a the definite article in front of it, it has to mean that that person referred to is explained by both of those titles. So what does he call Jesus? By the righteousness of our God and Savior. Now, in the original Greek, there's an interesting thing. The original Greek has it this way. Let me translate it. By righteousness of our the God and Savior, Jesus Christ. That's the way it's written in the original. We don't do that in English. So English drops that second the. But when that the is in there, you follow me? Here's the literal Greek. By righteousness of our the God and Savior, Jesus Christ. That the there that we drop out in English, that's there in Greek, it defines Jesus, and it must put both of those nouns together. And the two nouns are God and Savior. If you ever wonder if there's a clear teaching in the scriptures that say Jesus is God, here it is. Because this Greek grammatical structure cannot be interpreted any other way. It's called the Granville-Sharp rule. Came out years and years ago. They realized that these two nouns tie it to Jesus Christ. He is our God and Savior. And that's important when we're trying to ask the question, who is the ultimate author of Peter's words? He's an apostle. And an apostle, therefore, is one who is sent out in the authority of another. And so when Peter spoke as an apostle, and we use these titles so loosely today, I was reading somewhere about a guy who calls himself a prophet, and you got to be careful about that. And a lot of guys call themselves apostles. Nobody was an apostle in the same way as these guys were. But when an apostle spoke, gentlemen, he spoke with the very words of and in the authority of the one who sent him. Peter is saying, I'm an apostle of Jesus Christ. So when I speak, I'm not saying my own words. Why? Because I'm a servant. I'm a bondservant. But I am an apostle. And so it's important for us when we think about the exegesis of this text to understand that Peter understood that the ultimate author of his words was Jesus Christ. And then he says this in this verses 20, 21, knowing no prophecy of scripture come from someone's own interpretation. For no prophecy was ever produced by the will of men, but men spoke from God as they were carried along by the Holy Spirit. How did Peter get his words? The Holy Spirit gave him the words and he was carried along, and that's called prophecy. Sometimes we think prophecies are guys that have wild visions. You read Ezekiel lately? The wheels, we read Ezekiel and we go, man, that's a prophet. That guy was on mescaline or LSD. That was weird. No, it was a vision. And some of the prophecies in the Bible are that way. But most of the prophecies in the Bible are simply speaking forth the word of God. Not from weird visions, just speaking straight forward. And the best of the apostles and prophets is right here in the Bible. This is my longest point, but it's important for us to understand, men, if we are going to have confidence, we got to have truth to give us manly confidence. You want confidence? You want confidence in building a relationship with your wife? Then you got to find the truth in Scripture. You want confidence in how to live the right way? Don't get it from the world. You got to get it from someone who will give you infinite and infallible and unchanging truth. Confidence comes from truth, not just ideas. A man's confidence comes when he understands that he is basing his life on God's revealed truth. All other sources of confidence is bravado. It's manly based, and it will not last, particularly in those times when you feel, like I feel sometimes, very insecure. I've got three other points. I'm going to go real quick. And you're going, yeah, right. No, yeah, really. Promise, I can do this. The ultimate author of the Bible is God, and that brings the confidence that Peter needed. I want you to secondly understand the reliability of the human authors. Peter goes on and he brings this point out in verses 16 and following. We did not follow cleverly devised myths. A myth. How many read Greek mythology in college or in the past? You've read mythology. Mythology reads like a story that's put together. It reads like fiction, doesn't it? Because it is fiction. A myth is a story that was put together to explain something that humans didn't understand. So Peter says, listen, I want you to think that all this stuff we've talked to you about Jesus is a myth. We didn't make this stuff up. we were there. On the mount, and he's, this reference is to the Mount of Transfiguration, isn't it? Which is in all three of the Synoptic Gospels, Matthew 17, Mark 9, Luke 9. It's all there. The Transfiguration, where Jesus went up on the mountain with his disciples. You all familiar with that, right? This is what he's talking about. He says we were eyewitnesses of his. What's the word he uses? Majesty. Jesus looked like a normal man walking around, but on the Mount of Transfiguration, the deity and the glory and the majesty shone through. Freaked Peter out, it's in the original text, in a footnote. I am freaked out right now. And what Peter said was, Peter was so thrown by this, he said, Lord, this is good for us to be here. Let's build some booths and stay here forever. It's like a summer camp. It's not a myth. This is so important. The reliability of the human authors. Guys, we need to understand that confidence comes from true identification of people who are really there. And we know in the resurrection, Corinthians tells us, 1 Corinthians 15 tells us, there were over 500 people who saw the resurrected Christ. This leads to the third point. I told you I could pull this off. It's important to understand not only the ultimate author of the Bible and the reliability of the eyewitnesses of the authors of the human authors of the New Testament, it's important to understand the logical response to the Bible of Christians. And this is where he says in verse 19, and so we have something more sure. Because we were eyewitnesses, because we're apostles, we have something more sure. You do well to pay attention. You do well to pay attention. As to a lamp shining in a dark place. Picture yourself in a country road someplace out in the middle of nowhere and your car breaks down and the moon is not out. There's no stars because the clouds are out and you can see barely in front of your hand. And you go, I don't know what I'm going to do. And you look down there and you see one little light about a mile, maybe 2 miles away. What are you going to do? Because you're a logical human being, because you don't know where you are, because it's pitch black, you're going to go toward the light. Of course you are. I love these commercials that we have so much now on these flashlights that are available. My son got me one. I carry it with me everywhere. They say carry these flashlights that could just blind people. Don't even carry a gun. Just carry one of these flashlights. I love that. I can't wait to shine that in somebody's face. The logical response to the truth of the gospel, the truth of the Bible, is to obey it and do. Isn't that logical? Because we live in a very dark world, don't we? Is there fake news out there? I love that expression, by the way, that's coming. There's a lot of fake news out there, both sides of the political spectrum. There's always been a lot of fake news out there. And so many Christian men are bewildered on how to live in a world where there's so much darkness and so much fake news and so much false news that a Christian man oftentimes doesn't know how to live. Here's how you have confidence. Soak yourself in this and let this guide you. Jesus redeemed you that you're and me, that our minds and our hearts would be renewed by the scriptures, guys. And this is what guides us in our singleness, in our marriage, in our work, in every way. And what my goal here today, my ultimate challenge, I'm going to say when I send you out of here today, is to soak yourself in this. Because this is what builds confidence, even when I feel insecure. Even when our culture is saying, this moral action is right, and you know it isn't because it's not in here. Okay, I'm going to get a little more strident here. You say, is that possible? Yeah, here you go. You ready? Here we go. Mormons look to the Book of Mormon, don't they? The Pearl of Great Price and the Doctrine of Covenants. Now, I grew up with Mormons. I have a lot of Mormon friends. I love them. They're great people. But Jesus would say about their source of authority, well, what would he say? He would say, well, we have freedom of religion and freedom of speech. We do in America. Isn't that a wonderful thing? And we must champion freedom of speech and we must champion freedom of religion in America for all people, because if we don't, we're not going to get it. But Jesus said to the Pharisees something that he would say to the Mormons, and that is, and I'm not picking on Mormons, I'm going to pick on some other people too. He would say, they're blind guides to the blind. He would say, they're liars. Now that sounds harsh. Now what do I say to my Mormon friends? I say, you're a blind guide to the blind. I say, you're a child of hell. No, I smile and I say, let me talk to you about the foundation of the Book of Mormon. It's a mythical book. Let's talk about that. Let's talk about the... But we have, as Christian men, we must call it what it is. Muslims follow the Quran. If you have not read the Quran, you must read the Quran. And we need to understand that Muhammad himself was illiterate. He couldn't read. He never wrote anything down. His words were written down. And only hundreds of years later were they ever published in the book called the Quran today. And the original documents are disputed across the board. You need to understand that. And if you're talking to a Muslim, you need to smile and be kind. And if you can get to some deeper things, you need to say, let me tell you the truth that we find in the Gospels. Because Jesus would call them blind guides to the blind. Be kind. Don't be a jerk. We don't need to be jerks. The guy that died and went to heaven was standing there and he was asking for his name to be found in the book of life. And God said, Peter said, yeah, your name is here, but you forgot that part about being a jerk about it. You believed in Jesus, but you were a jerk. No. Guys, that's not the point. They think we're jerks when what we need to be is truth holders and truth tellers. Smile, wince, cry, but tell the truth. Be sad when someone holds to error, but do not let them get away with error. Intellectuals today say that truth is relative, that there's no such thing as ultimate truth. And when they make the statement that there's no such thing as ultimate truth, they've made a statement that is therefore by their own definition false. They said there's no ultimate truth. Therefore, what you just said, that there's no ultimate truth, must be false, right? Call them on it. Confidence comes when men understand the truth and pass it on. And we've been way too nice as Christian men. The world was not changed by nice men. The world was changed by principled men of conviction. By the way, most of them died for their faith. Get your insurance policies paid up. The ultimate author of the Bible is God. The reliability of the human authors of the Bible help us trust the Bible. The logical response to the Bible is to trust it and to defend it. But understand this, and this is the last point. It's even quicker than that. The inevitable and unending war against the truth. In your lifetime, I talked to the mayor of Winter Springs years ago. I was getting tired of all the, this is when they were redoing Tuscarora Road. Some of you remember Tuscarora Road over there in Winter Springs getting fixed. I was tired of all the bumps and the flat tires I was getting. And I said, Mr. Mayor, how long are we going to do construction around here? He said, for the rest of your life. I said, okay, there it is. I'd just gotten a flat tire fixed. I got another flat tire of the week for us. These dumb trucks that drop nails and all that kind. For the rest of your life, there's going to be an unending war against the truth. And guys, pagans are going to be pagans. This has been going on since the time of Jesus. Don't say, I just wish, there wouldn't be a battle. There's going to be a battle until you go home or Jesus comes here. False prophets also arose among the people. This is the Old Testament. This is the New Testament. It happens in the church. Just as there will be false teachers among you who will secretly bring in destructive heresies. Heresies are false teaching. And they're all destructive, guys. No heresy is not destructive. Right? Here, let me bring in some lies into the church. And let's see. Hey, I'm going to bring in some lies today, okay, in our home group. Wouldn't that be great? No, it's destructive. All heresy is destructive, even denying the master who bought them, bringing upon themselves swift destruction. And many, listen to this, many will follow their sensuality. False teachers are based on a sensuality that comes from within. Basically, it's a sensuality that says, I want more money, I want more sex, I want more power. And some of the false leaders that we have leading today in America, it's sensuality that's driving them, not the love for Jesus Christ. And because of them, the way of the truth will be blasphemed. You see, when false teachers come in and they encourage false teaching, what does it do? It makes even pagans look at Christians and say, I don't want anything to do with that. And in their greed, they will exploit you with false words. A false teacher, somebody who really does not hold to this, will exploit you. You are somebody to be used and manipulated. And so if you're following a teacher that doesn't stick to this, they're out to get you. Just because they're not following you, they're out to get you. Don't follow them. Their condemnation from long ago is not idle. Their destruction is not asleep. We're in a war. We're in a war against good and evil, right and wrong, God and Satan. And it will happen until Jesus comes back. And so we need men who are not easily swayed by intellectuals or by politicians or by the majority of people who disagree with them. If we don't follow the word, we will be passive men, weak men, unconfident men. Pete, what do you really feel? Talk about it around your table, and then we'll get you out of here on the right time. There's three questions at the bottom of your outline. This is a place where God builds men. He forges us. Thank you, Tom, for making that for Isla every week. Man, I'm going to do that. AJ. What in the world did you do this past Saturday?
I turned another year older.
And?
And I asked my girlfriend to marry me.
And she said? Wait. What'd she say?
She said yes.
All right. All right. We stand with you, buddy. That's exciting. That's exciting because you're going to need about 600 guys to help you with that. And awesome. We stand with you. That's great. All right, Rick, stick your hand up. Okay, Rick's paw is up. Three guys. To stand with us on April 1, Bishop is going to be leading the worship time with Kyle Carden. Right, Kyle and you're putting together. Kyle's leading it. Kyle, stand up, Kyle. You want to see a guy that's scary looking? That's Kyle right there. Kyle's going to be leading the worship. You're working, putting the teams together. April 1, I hate this. When Rick Lee told me about this, I had a wedding planned. I have a best friend's daughter for years, and I'm going to be up in Alabama doing a wedding. I can't be there, but Forge is going to be represented. And so get with Rick. Okay, that's that one. Then this Saturday night, Better Man event, I got two free tickets. This is grace. I'm going to give one to Woody because I know Woody doesn't. You don't have your ticket yet, do you?
I don't think so.
There it is. One other guy who wants to go but does not have a ticket. It's free. It's paid for. Oh, my goodness. There it is. Pass it back to my brother back there, will you, Tom? Thank you. All right. You are in. What else? Stand-up table leader meeting right afterwards. A tech team meeting right afterwards with Michael at the back. Stephen Ray, who is a communications major, and I were talking the other week. You learn 10% of what you read, 30% of what you read out loud, and 80% of what you teach. Did you catch that? 10% of what you read, 30% of what you read out loud, 80% of what you teach. Teach what you learned today, and you will learn it. On October 31st of this year, we're going to be celebrating a 500th anniversary. Because the church had developed along the lines since the first century. And the church began to teach some things that were quite crazy. For instance, it was teaching that you could get to heaven if you were you believed in Jesus Christ. If you followed the traditions of the church, you could get to heaven. But there was a step you had to follow before that, and that was this. You had to be baptized too. You had to be baptized. You had to believe in Jesus Christ. You had to do good works. You could get to heaven, but only after of spending an undetermined amount of time in a place called purgatory. Purgatory was the place. You see, baptism wiped away your original sin inherited from Adam. Purgatory was a place where you worked off all the sins that you committed in your earthly life after your baptism. Where is that found in the Bible? It's not. But they were teaching it. And then some really swift marketers came up with an idea. Because you could be in purgatory having your sins purged away by the fires of a quasi-hell. You could be there millions of years, hundreds of thousands of years, but eventually you would work off your sin and get to heaven. Therefore, your getting into heaven was by your own works, right? But the marketers of the church came along and they said, if you give a donation to the church, we'll give you a certificate, and the leaders of the church, the pastors of the church, we will authenticate your freedom from purgatory. And it was slick. I love it. I'd like to use it here at Forge. Their marketing slogan was this: as soon as the coin in the coffer rings, a soul from purgatory springs. Is that slick marketing? I can't say it in German, but the Germans were just masters of it until this one theological professor, this guy had been studying the Bible, came along and he said, I don't find that in the Bible. We got to clean it up. And so Martin Luther was brought before the Diet of Worms and other places. This was he was put on trial. And he said, this is what the Bible teaches. In fact, what he did first was he put 95 points, nailed it to the door of Wittenberg, and said, let's talk about it. It was called a disputation. Let's talk about it. And they didn't want to talk about it. They wanted to kill him. So the bottom line is, he says this in front of the leaders, the kings, the princes, as well as the lords of the church. Since then, your majesty and your lordships desire a simple reply, I will answer without horns and without teeth. Unless I'm convicted by the scripture and plain reason, I do not accept the authority of popes and councils, for they have contradicted each other. My conscience is captive to the word of God. I cannot and I will not recant anything, for to go against conscience is neither right nor safe. God help me. Amen. It is not right nor safe for us to go against the scriptures. So don't. The challenge: soak yourself in the word and let it change your life. Kevin DeYoung put it this way. He said, the most effective means for bolstering our confidence in the Bible is to spend time in the Bible. Let's pray. Father, thank you for my brothers. Thank you that we are descendants of a very brave and confident man who found his confidence not in his intelligence, not in his physique, not in his degrees, not in his accomplishments, but in your revealed word of God. Thank you that we have that word today. Be with me, be with my brothers, that we would build a life of confidence based on your truth and the gospel that we find in it. For we pray these things in the strong name of our risen Savior Jesus. And all God's men said, amen. Amen. Go to work. Have a great week.